Welcome, everyone, to this evening's event. My name is Michael Erickson. I'm the chairman for Young Americans for Freedom at Utah Valley University, joined on stage by Joshua Carr, chairman of Provo YAF. We welcome all who have traveled to attend tonight's historic event. We're thrilled to have with us Yeonmi Park, North Korean defector whose life is nothing less than a modern miracle. We are grateful for the attendance of members of the state legislature, city councils of Orem and Provo, and staff from Utah's federal delegation who have made it a priority to be here tonight. Students from all over the state have gathered here at our campus, which we're so proud of. We also like to express gratitude to Representative Tyler Clancy, the Bonham family, for contributing to this event. We want to especially thank Mr. Keith Work and his contributions to tonight's event. Tonight's event also wouldn't be possible without the support of the Gary Herbert Institute for Public Policy and Young America's Foundation. We're especially grateful to have in attendance the 17th Governor of Utah, Gary Herbert, and his wife, former First Lady Jeanette Herbert. We'll now start with an opening prayer offered by Joshua Carr, after which McKenna Lambert will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful that we can be here tonight, and we pray that all of us will be safe here as well as traveling home. We're grateful that Yeonmi Park could join us today. We pray for her safe travel home as well. And Heavenly Father, we also pray at this time for the welfare of our nation, and that each one of us can do our individual part in protecting the freedoms that we enjoy. We're grateful for all of our blessings. We're grateful for our health and for all that thou hast done for us, and pray that we can be instruments in thy hands for serving thy children. And these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Born in North Korea, human rights activist and TED speaker Yeonmi Park grew up in a punishing society devoted to the worship of Kim Jong-il. But at the age of 13, she and her family made a daring escape to China in search for a life free of tyranny. Park urges audience to recognize and resist the oppression that exists in North Korea and around the world. An insightful and candid speaker, Park is fast becoming a leader of oppressed people all around the world. Her address to One Young World on the horrors of detention camps, political executions, and sex trafficking has been viewed over 320 million times. The BBC named Park one of their top 100 global women. Park is also the author of two New York Times best-selling books, In Order to Live and While Time Remains. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Yeonmi Park.
Good evening, everyone. I get still very nervous before I speak. And then usually when I get so nervous, I tell myself this one thing that keeps me calm, which is I tell myself that even if you go out there, say something so stupid, you're not going to be getting executed at the end of the day. So what do you have to lose? So go out there and tell your story. I'm standing here as an American myself, and it's quite an interesting time to be an American. Not that many of North Koreans made it to America. Guys, do you know actually how many North Koreans made it to America over the last 80 years? About 209 of us made it to freedom in 80 years. And I am one of that person. I came to America with a great hope, of course. This is the land of the free, home of the brave. I came to study at Columbia University when I came here for the first time. When I went to Columbia University, there I saw something that I could not really believe. Because in that university, my fellow students at Columbia were learning exact same things that I learned in North Korean classroom, which meant that all the problems that we have in the world right now exist because of white men, because of American capitalism, and because of this country. And the professors were telling us the only solution to all these problems is us destroying America, is us destroying American Constitution, and then rebuilding this country in the name of equity, which meant socialism. So I'm here standing here today to tell you what actually socialism is. All these professors that I met at Columbia, they learned socialism in their textbooks, in their comfortable room with the air conditioning on, with their nice computer with the internet on. And they were saying amazing thing about socialism and how this is gonna save all us and take us to a paradise. And I, instead of learning as a theory, I lived it because I was born in North Korea, so-called the socialist paradise. When I was born in North Korea, I was born there at the end of 1993. That's really right after when Soviet Union collapsed. And there's a saying, right? Socialism only works when you until run out somebody else's money. That was North Korea's case. It kind of worked until Soviet Union was subsidizing North Korea's economy. But once the Soviet Union was collapsed, there's no more subsidy coming from the abroad, and the regime could not feed their people. And that's the time when I was born in the country. Even though socialism promises equality of outcomes, where everybody is equal. You know, guys, in North Korea right now, there are 51 different classes. And you wonder how. Like, Koreans are not like Americans. There's no different race. We are all the same people. How can you possibly dividing people into 51 different castes? They divided into different castes based on what our ancestors did, deserving you anything. So if my great-grandfather was a landowner, the government said, your blood is tainted. Imagine that. Your government tells you that your blood is tainted. Your genetics is oppressive. And that's how they put you in different castes, based on what your ancestors did, not based on what you did. And this is what's happening in America right now. If your ancestors owned the slaves, you are guilty, because that's what they did. Your genetics is oppressive. And there's just think about big three categories. We think about common like names of the fruits. Number one, top class, on the top third class, we call them tomatoes, because they are red outside and they are red inside. Therefore, there's no doubt you're unbelievably believing in socialism. That's why the top third class. The middle class is called the apples. You're red outside, but what's inside the apple? You're white. You're not red. So you're questionable. We are not quite sure you actually believe in socialism. Therefore, you need government's surveillance. Bottom, that third of the population, this class is you're completely screwed because you are grape. You're not even red outside. So that's called a hostile class. These are the people whose grandparents were the intellectuals, whose grandparents were capitalists, who were landowners, who were building factories. These are the bottom class, is a hostile class. You are going to be persecuted generation after generation. There's no ending on this persecution. Until the end of the day, this bottom third of the class in North Korea gonna forever dying and from the starvation. So when I was growing up there, government determines what individuals can eat. This is the core of socialism. It's by force. Government determines who gets fed and who gets to live. And they decided we will not deserve to live. So there are millions of people dying, especially where I was living in the northern part. So the officials were going to Kim Jong-il at the time and told him, "Dear leader, there are millions of people dying from starvation. What shall we do?" Do you know what Kim Jong-il said? And this is a call of socialism again, which means hating humanity. Now in America, how often can you hear that humans are disease? We are the disease to Mother Earth, right? Just like that, Kim Jong-il said to the cadres in North Korea, said, "It's easy to socialism when there are less of them. So let them die." That's why North Koreans were left to die by millions in the 90s. Despite this kind of government persecution, the very first thing my mother taught me as a young girl to protect me, which was saying, she said, "Don't even whisper, because birds and mice couldn't hear me. If I said one wrong word, that was going to kill up to 3 to 8 generations of my family, from both my mom and my dad's side." And that's very early on. I learned not to even whisper, but not to even think, because there's even no point of thinking, right? One wrong word can get all of you get killed. Why do you even bother to think? That's why in North Korea, there's no critical thinking. Nobody knows how to think critically. I remember going to South Korea, and then people were saying, "Why did you believe that Kim Jong-il doesn't go to the bathroom? You know, why did you think he's a god? He's obviously a fat dictator." And it doesn't compute to me, because in North Korea, every day I believed that Kim Jong-il was starving just like me, because that's what party told us. But then if you had a capability of thinking for yourself, if you just look at the picture of Kim Jong-il, he is the fattest guy in the picture. There's no chance of him starving. But as a brainwashed person, I did not know that he was well-fed. I thought he was starving. And at school, every day, I learned to hate you guys, American bastards. That was a one word. Even in my math class, it was a way to brainwash us by the government. They said, "There are 4 American bastards. You killed 2 of them. How many American bastards are left to kill?" That was a math problem I solved. And now, don't worry, I'm a one of bastards like you guys. After all this brainwashing, by the time when I was 13, it really came to a thing. Because as you can see, I'm on a 5-inch high heel. North Koreans actually, on average, 5-inch shorter than South Koreans because of malnutrition. And even till this day, I'm not able to gain weight because my organs were never fully developed. And by the time when I was 13, I could not find any more dragon flies or grasshoppers. I couldn't find any more food, so I had to find a way to survive. And luckily, I was living in the border town of North Korea. And I looked at nighttime to Chinese side, and they somehow had electricity in China. And I thought, if I go where the lights were, I could find a bowl of rice. As a North Korean, you don't escape for freedom, because in North Korea, you don't even have the word free there. There's no word for love in North Korea. Kim Jong-un literally banned Mother's Day because he was so afraid if we love our mothers, we are not going to love him as much. So people in North Korea don't even know that we are allowed to love another human being other than the dictator and the Communist Party. So this time at 13, escaping from North Korea, I wasn't searching for freedom. I wasn't searching for anything other than a bowl of rice. With that little promise, My sister, at 16, she escaped through Yalu River into China. And I couldn't go with her initially because I got really, really sick. So my parents had to take me to a hospital. And this is where I really want to show people how the government provided free healthcare works in natural socialism. When my mother took me to a hospital to see what was wrong, in the hospital, they don't have any x-rays or anything. Just doctors rubbed my belly and told my mom she might just have appendicitis. We have to operate on her. And that afternoon, they opened my stomach without any painkiller. And turned out, it wasn't appendicitis. I just had an infection and malnutrition. But doctors got so embarrassed, so they still removed my fine appendix from me and closed me back up. So don't worry, I'm going to go sue these doctors when I go back to North Korea. This is the one thing I learned from America. And after the operation, of course, my mom had to go to black market to buy penicillin, right? Government does not give you anything free. She had to bribe the doctors to take care of me. And nurses coming back, and she was using 1 needle to inject every patient in the hospital. And that's when we learned, in North Korea, people don't die from cancer, they die from infection. And after this operation, I decided to get out of North Korea, whatever it took. And that meant crossing the Yalu River, that where my sister escaped to. I followed my sister's note with my mother, and then we found a lady somehow was willing to help us to go to China. And we didn't question it because what was the point? We are dying from starvation anyway. We had to go to China. The reason why this lady was helping us to go to China was because she was selling us as sex slaves. As soon as we got to China, the first thing I saw was my mother being raped. And at the time, as a North Korean girl, we didn't have a sex education, so I did not even know what sex was. And then after this rape, this Chinese man told us, you guys are like less valuable than pigs in China. Because, you know, during this World War II, there were Jewish people were escaping, and then people were capturing them and sending them to Auschwitz. It's like that. Chinese Communist Party does not recognize us as a political refugees, so they catch us, they send back to us to North Korea to die. So therefore, in China, we are running from police, the authority. And then where do we go to? Only human traffickers capture us. And that's why they set us. But sold as a sex slave in China is actually not the worst thing can happen to you as a North Korean. There are 4 places that North Korean women end up right now in the 21st century. The first place that buy North Korean women are the ones, the organ harvesters. They buy us, and they take our organs out of us, and they discard our body. Number 2 place that they buy us is a brothels, where there's no even window. They put a girl in a room and then get her raped like 500 times a day until she dies. And they don't want to even spare time to give her food. It's just better off give her the drug and let her rape more so they can make more money and then buy you a new body. After all, they bombed my mom for $65 and they bombed me for over $200 in the 21st century. And the last place is so-called husbands. It's a countryside Chinese farmers. How many of you guys know about Chinese one-child policy? A lot of you. Somehow, government thought it'd be a good idea to control population by measuring how many kids people can have, right? So because of this evil policy, so many Chinese people aborting girls, killing girls, And now, there are 33 million men in China cannot find wives. And this number gonna keep growing and more. So this man needs women. And Chinese Communist Party, they don't want the revolution of this angry men cannot find wives. So they are trying to appease this man, and they are letting them to buy North Korean women and rape them and human traffic them. So in the village of men, 20, 50 men, they chop in a few bucks and they buy one girl and they share this girl. And that's where I ended up. After 2 years of my slavery, by some miracle, I met the Christian missionaries coming from South Korea who were rescuing North Korean defectors. And these missionaries told me there was a way to be free. And I asked this lady, like, what do you mean there's a way to be free? And she said, like, how would you explain freedom to a North Korean girl? You're not gonna tell her it's like freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, and freedom of religion. She did a perfect job to me. I was 15 years old at the time, in 2009 in China. You guys were born, right? In 2009. I was 15 and she said, sweetie, if you go to South Korea, you can wear jeans and you can watch K-dramas. And nobody gonna arrest you for that. Because in North Korea, jeans are made in America. Therefore, it's a symbol of capitalism. They send you to jail for that. If you watch a wrong movie, you get executed for watching a wrong movie in North Korea. So for me, I could not possibly understand. There is a place where human beings can choose what to wear and what to watch, and you don't get punished for that. So I told this lady, I want to do that. I want to risk my life for that. And that's how I understood freedom. And I asked them, how can I do that? How can I be free? And she said, well, it takes God. Because you have to walk across Gobi Desert from China to Mongolia. You have to cross 60 wire fences in minus 40 degrees Celsius. And if you don't get killed any of that, you might be able to go to South Korea from Mongolia. From some miracle, I did not die in that Gobi Desert. I did not die from the cold or starvation. I survived the desert. And the chance of making that desert was not even 1%. That's why most of North Koreans don't survive the desert. I made it. I was sent to South Korea. And I thought, this was my freedom moment, that my journey to freedom kind of ended. But when I got to South Korea, I learned this lesson. It's not easy to be free. It's exhausting to be free. Once I got to South Korea, they said, what do you want to do with your life? I was like, why? Can't you just not tell me? Can't you just not tell me what job should I have? What I need to study, what I need to wear. And it's like, no, here, you need to be responsible for choices you're making. I learned in South Korea that freedom was responsibility. It wasn't just watching K-dramas wearing jeans. In South Korea, I had to be responsible for the choices that I was making. And after 5 years of learning freedom, I came to America. And now here is another story begins. In America, I became a mom. And my son got a birth certificate saying, mom was born in North Korea and dad was born in America. And only in freedom, this child can exist. Because when North Korean women in China, when they are sold and raped, of course they get pregnant. When they're sent back to North Korea, before they get killed, they kill the baby first. They don't believe in mixed blood in North Korea. That's how racist communists are. And I'm raising this child, and now I live in New York City. And I have so many friends currently, perfectly nice people, are fantasizing terror, like destroying America, because they want to try socialism so bad. And I asked them one day, like, why do you hate capitalism so much? What about capitalism that makes you so want to throw up about it? And they said, look outside. Like, there are billionaires and there's a homeless person. Capitalism creates inequality. Therefore, it's evil. We need to destroy capitalism. And you know, I was like, my jaw dropped. What do you mean that you can be a billionaire? So if you work hard, like Steve Jobs, create an iPhone, like Elon Musk creating rockets, you mean that I can be a billionaire? What a concept. Seriously, what a thing to celebrate. That you can rise up. You don't need to be all equally poor and starving together. The fact the sign of inequality is not a sign of oppression. It's a sign of progress. That's something we need to cherish and celebrate. And that's when I understood. These kids that I meet are so brilliant in many other ways, but they did not get any good education. They never learned actual reality of socialism. And now I live in New York City. Instead of worrying about getting killed by Kim Jong-un's agent, I worry about getting killed by mentally ill homeless people on subways. Literally every single day, I risk my life leaving my door, going to take a subway, go to work. And how do I solve this problem? I don't know. And I also don't know truly how many years that we have left to keep this country sane. But this time, I know. Because there's no place to escape to. If America falls down, guys, what's our plan? Are we gonna escape to North Korea? Are we gonna escape to China? Maybe the only place gonna be the moon with Elon Musk, right? But until that day comes, this is the only hope that we have. And this is the last hope that we have. I know that no country is perfect. I know that no nation is perfect. Nothing is perfect. That's life. But because of these few imperfections, that we want to throw away a country that gives a platform to a person like me, a sex slave who was sold for like a trash garbage. My worth was not even $300. But in America, I have a right that was given by God. When I read the Constitution, I could not believe it. This U.S. Constitution says that you have a right that was given by God, not by your state, not by your man, but by your ultimate creator of this universe. No state can take away from you. And that's America. So I hope you can join me to fight for America. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. No. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. You have created. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. We have a Q&A to go to. Thank you.
All right, everyone, as she said, it's time for the Q&A. If you'd like to ask a question, please line up along these back seats and line up right behind my friend Kate here, and we'll get to your questions.
Ms. Parks, thank you so much for coming to speak to us tonight. I really appreciate your courage and your bravery. And as you were speaking, a question came to mind. I was curious to what you'd say to those people who have fears, maybe not here, but for future, who might be worried about the retributions that come from speaking out and for standing for what they believe in. How do you reason with that, especially when those attacks can be targeted to your family and your friends? How did you deal with it, and what would you recommend to those facing similar situations?
Yeah, thank you. I know that what the the vengeance of the mainstream media is like. When I spoke out against the woke and the sympathizers of socialism, I was like literally canceled by FBI. Like literally I was invited to speak at FBI, and then the day before my event, the head of diversity at FBI calls me. You know that's a job, right? Head of diversity. And this lady calls me saying she has canceled the event because of my political opinions. And there are actual consequences currently in America standing up for your beliefs. But as I said, because of these consequences right now, losing your job, called as a racist and conspiracy theorist, next time when you stand up, it's going to be the three generations of your family's life. So if we keep, this is the thing, when I come to America, the first question that I was asked by people was like, are North Koreans stupid or something? Why there's no revolution? 80 years, same three fat Kim dictators been ruling. Not single one revolution is happening. What's wrong with you guys? Because of it. They go after eight generations of your family. And I think because of that, even though it's scary, this is a time to stand up. So we don't ever get to that point like North Koreans are. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeonmi, I wanted to tell you what a brave woman you are.
Thank you so much.
I think you're the bravest woman in the 21st century.
Thank you.
To have written the book In Order to Live, and to be honest, and to tell all these people, and to tell the whole world about the brutality and the cruelty and the horrible things that are happening in North Korea.
Thank you, sir.
You to also know that I know that your father, your deceased father, is standing here by you, and he's cheering you on because you are a very, very brave woman.
Thank you.
And I also want to ask you what you think of crossing borders and how we, as free people here in this room, can help the North Korean refugees who are the 330,000 or more refugees who are stuck in China.
Oh, thank you. I think, so it's one thing to be a sex slave in China and another thing to be a sex slave in America, right? And that's been happening. So over the last year, several years, the Chinese human traffickers are flying these girls to Mexico and then smuggling them in through the southern border to America. And they have created these brothels in California and around the country. And these North Korean girls, they don't speak English. They were so brainwashed by these human traffickers that they think American police is also dangerous. So now, the human trafficking that was happening in China is spread to America. And I think it's going to take us to stand up for this lawlessness. And also, first of all, that we have to go after China, because China sponsors dictatorship in North Korea. North Korea is run by CCP. That's the thing. Somehow we accuse Kim Jong-un for every problem, but Kim Jong-un cannot operate North Korea even 1 week without CCP's help. So the only way we can liberate North Korean people is holding China accountable, telling them don't sponsor dictatorship, and letting these sex slaves in China. Because North Korean defectors are not like any other refugees in the world. They have a nation willing to accept them as their citizens, South Korea. So South Korean constitution says anybody who were born in Korean peninsula are South Koreans. So if North Koreans just go to South Korea, they become Koreans automatically. And that's what we are asking of China. It's not like we are asking them to accept us as refugees or giving us status. Just don't catch us. Let us go through so we can go to South Korea. But even that, China is not cooperating. I think for that little demand we can make as an international society. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming. incredible book, very brave. I was touched reading the accounts of the trafficking in North Korea, and I've met similar people that have gone through that, you know, really unfortunate wives that, you know, can't go anywhere else. A lot of us here are college students graduating soon, and so I'm wondering, is there any organizations we can join, like Liberty in North Korea, to help not only sex slave, but also just political refugees, farmers from North Korea that are in China?
Yeah, there are missionaries are still risking their lives and rescuing North Koreans. So if anybody interested in rescuing operation, please let me know. But not only the rescuing project is happening when it comes to helping North Korean people, there are information campaign. So do you guys remember during the Germany, East Germany, West Germany, they were sending leaflets to spread information. So because North Korea does not have internet, we have an organization in South Korea. We send the leaflets to North Korea through DMZ. And in the leaflets, we tell them that Kim Jong-un goes bathroom. He's a dictator. You know, the Americans are not bastards. There's lots of food outside the world, you know. So this kind of information is so important to wake up North Korean people's eyes. Because we need to free their minds first, right? This is what when I learned about freedom. There's two types of dictatorships. Number one is physical dictatorship, we know. Like, they literally physically not giving you passport and detain you and control your physics, like body. Second dictatorship is way more important and is way more sneaky. It's called dictatorship of the mind, emotional dictatorship. That's what North Korea mastered it. They control what people think. And I think a lot of this dictatorship of the mind is happening in America too, but North Korean people are not even free to think. That's why this information is really important. Even when the day North Korea gets liberated, we don't want them to think that America is a horrible country, right? So sending this leaflet is so crucial to opening their eyes to see the rest of the world. Yeah, so there are NGOs that I can connect you guys to if anybody want to be a volunteer or want to do the rescue, any of it. There's so many NGOs working on this issue.
Thank you. I'd actually be very interested in that.
Awesome. Thank you. Let's connect. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Hello. First of all, I would like to thank you for your wonderful speech today.
Thank you.
I'm from South Korea. And as someone who was born and raised in South Korea, I've always been told about the division of my country, and then I've always been dreaming for the day for, you know, Korean Peninsula to become one again. And in order for that day to come, it will be crucial, it will be essential for North Korea to be freed first. And as always, freedom is not free, right? So that is why I always believe that freedom of North Korea should be done by the hand of North Korean people. And how would you evaluate the possibility of North Korean people themselves rise up for the freedom and overthrow the dictatorship? I mean, like, South Korea was also under dictatorship at some point, but then like, it was democratized by the people, right? So will there be any possibility of the revolution happen in North Korea?
So that's a great question. Like, what's the possibility of North Koreans rising up and demanding their freedom? As somebody who lived there, it's a, like, when I went to Colombia, I was really interested because my classmates were telling me how they are oppressed. You know, they are so oppressed because they identify themselves with the 10 different thousand ways, and we are not quite catching up with their pronouns. So I was like, that's interesting that you know that you're oppressed, because when you're actually oppressed, you don't know you're oppressed. That is the definition of the oppression. So in North Korea, people don't know that they are enslaved. So if you don't know you are a slave, how do you fight to be free? And I think that's why it's so hard with North Korea, because people don't even know they're oppressed. So I think if we help them to understand oppression and sending these leaflets and waking them up, maybe one day they will understand their situation and demand justice. So that's why I guess we gotta help them, and we at least have to pray for them. Yeah. So thank you.
I first want to say hello, Ms. Park, and thank you for coming here. I watched a lot of your videos on YouTube and subscribed to your channel.
Oh, thank you.
But I also wanted to let you know that I'm a homeless and a mental health person in America. Mm-hmm. And my question for you is, what type of treatment would a person like me get in North Korea? And how many people are mentally ill and homeless in North Korea?
Yeah, thank you for that question. This is a big passion of mine because when I came to America, I fell in love with this country because I could not believe there was like on the elevators, there were like little dots below. I was like, I asked them, what is this? It's like they're to assisting people who cannot see. There are so many ways that people help. But in North Korea, if you are disabled, they exile you from capital, first of all, and they put you in an institution. So if you are a dwarf, they send you a dwarf village and you cannot procreate again. And a lot of them are gone in the institution and we never hear from them and families can never visit them again. So they do not believe in human dignity in any way. So a lot of them, there's no chance of you becoming a homeless. That's the thing. When people are saying, oh, there are homeless in America, how evil is it? And when I came here, I was like thinking, like, what do you mean that you have right not to work? Because in North Korea, there's no such a thing. You cannot not work. Government's gonna send you a job. So they literally gonna send you a work camp. And of course, in America is not perfect, but that's the thing. Like in real, actual socialism, there's no chance of you choosing your own fate. And I'm going to pray for you. So thank you so much for your courage to come today.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you.
Hi there. I'm a huge fan of yours. I love you. I think you're fantastic.
Thank you.
My name is Jeb Jacoby. I am a history major from Massachusetts. I just wanted to say I have studied the history of North Korea extensively. I've read into it when it was originally a unified nation. The Japanese came in the 1930s. Mm-hmm. They took control of it. The Americans, towards the end of the war, came in from the south. The Russians came in from the top, and it divided, and which thus led to the Korean War. Mm-hmm. And what I was kind of, when I was listening to your speech, which was fantastic, by the way, the similarities to the things that you were describing to what the Japanese did to the Korean people during the 1930s and the 1940s, mm-hmm. like, how would you describe the social and like mental impact on the people in Korea during that time?
In North Korea or South Korea?
Yes, in North Korea.
Oh. I mean, so when I was writing my first book, In Order to Live, I was writing with the Penguin Random House. It's a great publisher. They know how to take care of their writers. And my editor was saying, like, Yeonmi, you have PTSD. You need to go therapy. So I was like, what's therapy, right? Yeah. And she's like, it's a place where you go and talk about how hard it was and talk about your emotions. And at the time, it was really interesting to me. Like, if I'm in a place to talk about how hard it was,
right,
I don't need a therapy. Like, I'm in a great place, right? It's just like that. So the idea of mental health or PTSD or therapy, that kind of concept doesn't exist in North Korea. Like, you are a revolutionary. Damn. Your only purpose in life is dying for serving for the party and the dear leader. No other things possible in your life other than that, serving the nation, and individuals don't matter. So those kind of concept is the first world concept. It's just how else would I put it? It's a beautiful thing, but yeah, so most of North Koreans don't even know what that is, and there's no even word for stress. Damn. When I came to America, there was people saying, like, I'm so stressed. Like, what do you mean? Because in North Korea, like, how can you be stressed if you are living in a socialist paradise? right? You cannot be. So governments does not give you the word to understand what stress is. So I learned so many new concepts when I came to America.
That's fantastic. If it were up to me, I'd nominate you for the Nobel Peace Prize.
Oh, thank you. You're so kind. Thank you so much.
If you could say one thing to the political leaders of the West, pick one at random, Joe Biden, what would you say?
I mean, I'm not like, what is the one thing I would say? It seems, I guess it's a thing now. America was a very religious country when it was founded upon, and they were serving God. They were answering to God, not to their own personal interest. And I see both sides in America, all the politicians are fighting for their personal interest. And I think that's why it's just a good thing for us not to trust them. I don't expect Biden to. Thank you. Yeah, it's a. If we can avoid them, we can avoid them, but we need the government to keep us safe, right? That's their job, keeping us from the foreign invasion and from the criminals, all of that. But they're feeling it right now. I think that's the thing where I don't expect them to behave morally in any sense. They're people. And they're going to fight for their interests. That's why it's so important for us to stay vigilant and keeping them on check. And so they don't going to sell our country for their own benefit. And that's why I don't even expect him to be a good person at this point. So thank you, yeah. Thank you so much.
Ms. Park, thank you very much for your bravery.
Thank you.
And I'm a black conservative. I love this country. I love the Constitution. And I'm dismayed because we're at a point in our history where we're losing our First Amendment rights. Mm-hmm. We're losing our Second Amendment rights. I'm LDS. I serve my mission in a formerly communist country. So I've seen, though I didn't live during that time, what comes of that. Mm-hmm. And I am so dismayed that my generation and those younger are afraid to speak up. Because they think they're going to be called racist, as if, and I love what you said, where God gave us these freedoms. They don't come from the state, and it's colorless. Mm-hmm. What can you say further than what you've already said to inspire my lovely brothers and sisters here of a lighter shade mm-hmm. that think that they let people think that it's racist to love America and love the Constitution? What more can you say to them to inspire them to speak out? Because we really are at a crossroads in this country. We're about to lose our freedoms.
I think you are the answer to that question. Like, you prove that freedom is colorless. I think that's why they hate people like you and me or Candace Owens. When, as a minority, when we say that white people are not racist, they are like, they have nothing else to add other than, oh, you're a CIA spy. Right? For me, they're like, okay, so what else can I say? Oh, she's a liar, she's a CIA spy. I think we need more people like you. I think that's all I say. We need more people like you to prove that this country does not have systemic racism. There are personal racisms. Look, just go to Korea, go to Japan. The racisms are everywhere. We are never going to get rid of that. But there is currently no systemic racism in America. And I hope more people like you and all of us to really show them that's not the case. And I'm so inspired by you. So thank you so much for sharing your story, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Yeonmi, mm-hmm. you've been through so much. I don't think we can all understand exactly how much you've suffered. So appreciate you sharing yourself with the world. And my question, I'm here with a group from the University of Utah. We have a new club, just a new chapter of Liberty in North Korea, mm-hmm. The international organization. And we recently had an activity or an event where we wrote letters to the Chinese embassy mm-hmm. In response to them sending a large group of North Korean refugees back. Mm-hmm. And my question is, do things like this make a difference? And also, you know, talking with my fellow club members, we feel kind of powerless in the face of China specifically, though I agree with you and believe that China seems like the key to the whole problem. But my question is, what specific things could make change in China possible, and where do us as college-age students fit into that?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I think the only hope is going to come from us electing somebody can hold China accountable in the White House. We know that's not Biden, obviously. I mean, his family making money out of this horrible government in China. But we have to choose a leader in the West, especially in America. China is number two economy in the world. We are the only ones can hold them accountable. Even no country in Europe can really have that much influence. So I think that next election is for us. We gotta choose somebody, understand the darkness of CCP, and hold them accountable and expose the darkness in them. Like we wonder, right? Like there are so many movies about Holocaust. Why there's not one single movie about North Korea's human trafficking in China? And the reason was everybody in Hollywood is in the pocket of China. So many corporations in America is in the pocket of China. And I think we as American consumers, we have the power. We have a power to not watch these movies, not to buy the certain products, really boycott certain products, and vote the president who can hold them accountable. And of course, writing those letters is the right thing to do. But I think the most important thing is going to be the election. And we just have to choose a person that understands the threat of China. And I mean, we just got to see what the policies are of these politicians going to do. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hi, Ms. Park. It's an honor to be in your presence. I'm studying to be a therapist and a social worker.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of people that we work with can be refugees. And some of them have come from horrific governments, really bad situations, and could even be North Korean defectors.
Mm-hmm.
And so my question is to someone like me or anyone in my field, what advice would you have for us working with these refugees and being some of the first responders when they come to America?
Well, thank you for your heart for people like me, first of all. My advice today, if I can offer my humble advice, is that don't victimize them. It was really interesting to me when I came to America. I liked to laugh a lot. And then like people will keep asking me, like, why are you so normal? Are you not supposed to be this like traumatized person, have like anxiety issues on a like medication or Xanax or something, right? And they couldn't understand like why I was so normal. In a way, like nobody like really made me think in South Korea that because of what I went through that I could not achieve what other people are achieving, right? So it's good to offer that compassion. It's good to offer that heart, like holding them their hands, but in a way, just telling them, oh, because you went through this, in a way that like you might not achieve this. I think that's what I saw with African Americans. For me, they are heroes. Look what they've survived. These are the most resilient people. And then we are telling them they are victims. Like, how on earth? Their grandparents went through so unimaginable, that's slavery. They thrived in that. And now we are telling this young generation of African Americans, they are the victims. They deserve government's handouts, right? And I think just like that, we can tell them, I think, sorry that you went through something horrific, but I think it's important for these survivors to realize what they can achieve because they are so strong, because of what they have survived. I don't know, I'm sure it's a very unusual thing, but at least that's what helped me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Parks, for coming out and speaking to us. I know that's it was pretty hard to hear your story, but it does inspire a lot of people, especially people I know that were also, a few were sex slaves, and mm-hmm. so I know it's kind of hard to go through that, and so I just want to say thank you for speaking to us, and I know it's hard. I do have a question. How do we connect if we want to volunteer?
Well, I'm on Twitter. It's, you know, Bird is freed, so. and Yaf can connect us. Yaf okay. has my contact. And yeah, there are many ways, so Twitter or Yaf. And I would love to connect you, any of you want to be involved in this movement and fighting for America or fighting for North Korean people or anything. Please, let's get connected and do this together. I mean, nobody can do this alone, right? Yeah. So I'm so grateful that I've met all of you and you made your time to come see me and hear my speech so we can work together. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Park, thank you for being here, and thanks for all the good you do in the world. My name is Jason Walton, and mm-hmm. my question is, I heard you mention how when you read the Constitution, mm-hmm. is the first time you realized that there were rights that you had from God mm-hmm. that weren't given to you by the government.
Yeah.
And I was hoping you could share with us what some of those rights are.
Oh, I mean, there are so many other rights the Constitution says, but I think what struck me when I read the Constitution for the first time that, you know, my existence, my worth came from government in North Korea, how they recognized me. But in America, my right as a person does not come from that. It's above that. And I think that's why the Constitution, the U.S. Constitution is so unique in that way. And that's why we are even protected from our own government's tyranny. Another right that I love in the U.S. Constitution is the right to bear arms. It's a lot of people saying that, like, this is why I believe in America, because we have guns. And hear me out, I know a lot of you are triggered right now. I know there are school shootings, I know there are, like, but, so, people saying, like, well, Obama has nukes, right? At the time I came, the Obama was the president, it's like, you know, how, with a single gun, how are you gonna fight against your government? Is that, there's no way your government will kill all of you. Then how are they going to become a dictator? How are they going to enslave? And imagine if North Korean people had guns in their hands. Who's on earth going to let 3 generations of your family get taken down and get killed? You're going to fight back in some way. Look at Hong Kong. 75% of people in Hong Kong marched on the street demanding their freedom from CCP. Because they did not have a single gun in their hand, that didn't matter. The majority didn't want it. They still gone that way. So because of that, it's so important us to keep that guns in our hands. And when the day comes, hopefully never, but if our government becomes our slave, like our owners, right, like a North Korean regime, that we can use that gun to free ourselves. And I think that is the most important right that I see besides all other rights that I see in the Constitution.
Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you, sir.
All right, everyone, just by the way, this will be our last question. Oh, wait, we've already done our last question. Sorry, everybody. There's two more questions.
Yay!
Sorry, don't listen to me at all. Okay, two more questions.
Thank you so much for your presentation. It was you said so many important things. So my name is Bogdan. I'm mm-hmm. from Ukraine.
Yeah.
And I was born 20 years past the collapse of Soviet Union.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I didn't live under the communism, mm-hmm. I've seen the consequences of communism.
Right.
Even though there is democracy in the system, people still have socialism in their heads.
Right.
Yeah.
And yeah.
I feel like when I moved here mm-hmm. to the U.S., I was shocked that a lot of people like seriously believe that they need socialism in this country.
Yeah.
It was wild for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that what you do is incredibly important to remind the people here that there are actually, as you said, the last hope. Like, if the U.S. will fall, we'll have a very dystopian future.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to thank you for everything you said and for everything you do.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
It's such a pleasure to meet you. Mm-hmm. I just was super excited to hear from you because I studied public health and am very passionate about helping women get out of abuse and that sort of situation. Mm-hmm. But what really stood out to me as you were speaking was I got kind of choked up when you started talking about motherhood. Mm-hmm. Because I'm actually expecting, I'm 7 months pregnant, so I'll be meeting my daughter soon. But I wanted to ask you, as someone who has experienced so many horrific things in your life and is so aware of the evil in the world, how have you, just mother to mother, how have you instilled hope in your child?
Thank you, and congratulations. What a blessing. I mean, how I instilling hope in my child is I learned the hard way that in America, parents are super obsessed of giving a good self-confidence to their children. They are so afraid to say no to their children. I'm sure it's not in Utah, but in New York. In a way, like saying no is like a death sentence. Like literally parents, like I have literally friends, they don't say no to their dog. Their dog is trash and they throw up, get sick. They say no to the dog because they don't want to hurt the dog's feelings. This is how far they've gone, right? But instead of hope, I think that, in a way for me, that doesn't really, it didn't really matter for me what hope or not. It's like, in a way, what is the right thing to do? Is that my son understands that nothing is free. When somebody says it's free, that's a lie, right? There can never be a free things. And letting him understand that education is a privilege, it's not a right. Healthcare is a privilege, it's not a right. So really helping him to understand the world early on and not teaching him this entitlement that you need to work for things that you can get it. So instead of like really focusing on painting the bright future for my son, every day I teach him the values of work and studying hard. I'm an Asian mom, like tiger mom, here I am, right? It's like he's asking, why do I need to do math? Because that's how you can understand and build things in the future, right? You have a responsibility to create things for others and work as a human being. So instead of like really focusing on that, I try to teach him the responsibility and discipline. And I think if we all did that with our children, America's future would be so much brighter. If your child identifies whatever that thing is, instead of worrying about trying to get their like confidence up, just like do the right thing. And so they don't become like Columbia students where they cannot handle the textbook. I remember before I go into class, my professors are sending us just trigger warning emails. In today's topic, in this reading material, we might deal with slavery, rape, or oppression. If this material triggers you in any way, you don't need to do the reading, you don't need to come to the class, you don't even need to tell me why it triggered you or not coming. It's like, what is the point of education then? Like, literally. So if we do tell our children no early on, I'm sure they are not going to need the trigger warnings later. So let's say a lot of no's to our children. So thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. It was such a pleasure.